If you haven't heard about Anchor, it's the easiest way to make a podcast. Let me explain. It's free. There's creation tools that allow you to record and edit your podcast right from your phone or computer. Anchor will distribute your podcast for you so it can be heard in Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and many more. You can make money from your podcast with no minimum listenership. It's everything you need to make a podcast in one place.
All right, everybody, welcome to the Prozone. This is the Professor Rick, and joining me on this glorious Sunday evening, on the end of August, is the DVD Freak and JJ Sins. Hello, gentlemen.
Hi.
What's up?
Don't sound so enthusiastic,
Hi.
Brother. Hi. Today we're going to be talking some SummerSlam 2007, but before we get into that, we want to tell you one thing. Danny is out tonight. He had a family emergency. We just want to say, Danny, we love you. Thoughts and prayers go out to you, and we'll hope everything's all right. Gentlemen?
I say we drink to that.
Let's have a drink.
Danny, love you, brother.
Thoughts. Cheers.
Man. All right, now this has been a really interesting week as well. I think it was last week we lost Kamala, or the week prior. And this week, we lost another WWE Hall of Famer and the legend leader of the Armstrong family, the Bullet, Bob Armstrong. Rest in peace, Bullet.
Yeah.
So, I was very saddened to hear this news. I came across it through the Road Dogg and Scott Armstrong's tweets. And he had to say, I've been a huge Armstrong fan pretty much my whole entire life. Brad Armstrong is probably one of the greatest, most underrated professional wrestlers in the history of professional wrestling. What do you guys think about them?
You know, he's a pioneer, and he has that lineage to him, too. So, you know, you feel for the family, and if it wasn't for him, you wouldn't have so many great moments.
Absolutely.
Not only for himself, but also for his family. So
absolutely.
Yeah, yeah, the patriarch, base of the family, actually. Yeah,
absolutely. Okay. And then you have, like, you know, future WWE World Tag Team Champion, Brian James, or Brian Armstrong, and, you know, Brad, and Scott and Steve. Everybody was just, that as a family, those guys just awesome, you know what I mean? I mean, you got guys like the Harts, you got the Armstrongs, I mean, I'm particularly an Armstrong family. Just saying, man, those guys. But I love my old school Southern wrestling, too. So
yeah.
You know.
Some good old Mid-South.
Yep, there you go. So as I stated, we are discussing SummerSlam 2007. This is not as weird of an event that I was led to believe. It's okay. I enjoyed it.
Okay.
For the most part, with the exception of final two matches, and then I have something to say with the third to final match about that. So go ahead, DVD Freak. What do you got to say there, buddy?
All right. So this was my pick for the SummerSlam series, and the reason I picked this is because I thought it would be a good discussion, because this event is nowhere near what it was supposed to be. There's so many different changes, but before I get to that, I want to talk about, I have the Blockbuster Edition.
All right.
And, come on, it's in the name, DVD Freak. So I was huge into Blockbuster growing up, and this is the copy I would always rent as a kid. Not as a kid, but, you know, when I was younger, I would always rent this. And when my Blockbuster went out of business, which I cried that day, but when my Blockbuster went out of business, I bought this. I used to rent this over and over again. And, you know, this pay-per-view means a lot to me because of that. Just my love for film and just DVDs. It's physical media itself.
Right.
But so many things were supposed to happen at this pay-per-view that didn't because of the Benoit incident. And, you know, Benoit being my all-time favorite wrestler, this one kind of hits home a little bit.
Right.
At Great American Bash 2007, the Jackass crew, which I'm a huge Jackass fan.
I am so sorry to hear that about you. Prior to recording some of the things that the DVD freak said, I wanted to go through and give him a virtual hug, but now you got me on that one, dude. I'm sorry.
I'll tell you what, though. My biggest pet peeve in wrestling history is celebrity involvement. So I was very against the Jackass crew showing up. But at Great American Bash, you had Jeff Hardy and Umaga. They were supposed to interfere in that match and have Jeff Hardy win, which he ended up losing. And Johnny Knoxville was the one that pulled out of this whole plan. So Vince was... Because obviously Johnny Knoxville, that's your star of Jackass.
Right.
So Vince got cold feet and just kind of pulled the entire plug. But that was going to lead to Umaga in a handicap match with the Jackass crew. And as much as I love Jackass, celebrities do not belong in wrestling. Sorry.
Out of all the times that I think Vince makes the wrong decisions, I think he made the right decision there.
I do. Like, trust me, I do too.
A load of shit right there. Jesus Christ.
Yeah, celebrities do not belong in wrestling, no matter what. Maybe Cyndi Lauper, but that's about it.
That's about where I draw the line there, because I was like, you know, I mean, I was a kid when that happened, and, you know, it brought wrestling to the mainstream, basically, at that point, you know?
Yeah, real quick, some other things that were supposed to happen. Umaga and Jeff Hardy was also on the table, but Jeff Hardy got suspended. Wow. And 10 people got suspended a week after this pay-per-view, including Mr. Kennedy, John Morrison, which is why he dropped the title to Punk.
Right.
You know, this pay-per-view, you know, you had all the winners.
Mm-hmm.
And then the next week, so many people dropped titles and so many plans changed because... Basically, they were trying to prove, oh, no, we have a wellness policy because of the Benoit incident. Right. And The Undertaker was actually, you know, he was injured at this time back in May. The original plan was for him to return at this pay-per-view. But that plan was also nixed where because Vince was like, oh, no, we let all our superstars come back when they're allowed. When they're basically, we leave the decision to them, because he was injured, and he wanted to make himself look better because of the whole Benoit incident. So he's like, "Oh, we gave Undertaker a few weeks," and Undertaker ended up coming back at Unforgiven that year anyway, 3 weeks later.
Right.
But the Undertaker was supposed to be the big moment of this pay per view. But Vince is like, no, he's injured, so we gave him some extra time off. And this pay-per-view was, to me, SummerSlam is always the second biggest pay-per-view of the year. It may not be the most popular. I think the Rumble is always more popular than SummerSlam. Right. But
it's setting up for the grandest stage of them all. You know
exactly. When you have SummerSlam, you have some marquee matches, and you can really see, watching this pay-per-view, that they were still recovering from the Benoit incident.
Right.
Yeah.
I thought, surprisingly, one of the things that I was watching, that the crowd was a little bit more electric and involved for certain matches, which, at this time period, especially in the earlier 2000s through the mid, I mean, we're only 2020 now, but, you know, it... Crowds seemed to be dead at times during, you know, you'd get your crowd reaction during the intros, but once the match started, it just turned to silence, or once in a while there'd be a boom. But the crowd is seeing pretty electric for this show, especially, the early matches. So I'm trying to look at my notes here. Sorry. So, yeah, I mean, it seemed like it was a pretty electric crowd. Maybe they were electric for the bigger shows. I'm just trying to remember offhand.
It was a rowdy crowd. That's one thing I know.
Yeah. Especially during the main event, I didn't watch the whole thing. I was kind of in and out of the room, but you know, any match, like I said, I was before talking, before JJ joined the conversation, I was telling DVD Freak that anytime John Cena was on headlining a pay-per-view, I always walked out of the room and just shut it off and said, "All right, my night is done," kind of a thing, because you know, I never saw what was entertaining about him. Now, but I do have to say this, and I think I've told you guys this before, that I always respected him outside of the wrestling business.
Yeah,
his charitable work, his work with kids, as a human being, but on my WWE television, I just don't care for the character and don't care for him being pushed like as crazy as he was, you know?
Well, it's become a running joke that John Cena and Randy Orton, that match has happened so many times on pay-per-view. But at this time, this was very important because this was their first singles match on pay-per-view. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I'm a Randy Orton fan. I don't know about you guys. I've always said he's like a Brock Lesnar. When he wants to try, he can put on a great show, but then 90% of the time, he's just lazy. The talent is there. It's just the motivation and the money. Randy Orton can phone it in, and he'll still get a contract. So,
yep. When it comes to Randy Orton, I've said this a million times. I love his dad. His father was one of the greatest wrestlers.
Yeah.
Terribly underrated in the WWE or WWF. You watch him in, even if you watch him against, you know, he's had some great matches in WWE, but nothing really sticks out because he was, majority of the time, he was like Piper's sidekick or lackey, you know, for a good number of years. But you watch him in the NWA, you watch him in any of the Southern Territories prior to coming to WWF. He was a great worker. Don't ever do that again. Scared the shit out of me. DVD Freak.
I'm sorry. I was checking my battery.
All right. Maybe we should start talking about this. All right. Outside of.
I enjoyed the intro of this. Or wait, Rick,
yeah.
Did you go over what this was in the. Did you go over everything in detail where it was in the crowd?
Nope. I had not hit that yet. About to. Continental Airlines Arena, East Rutherford, New Jersey. They love to bring SummerSlam to Jersey, don't they? There was an attendance of 17,441. Buy rate, pay-per-view buy rate, 537,000. The tagline, the party is over. Now, if that isn't the dumbest shit, I mean... We've had some pretty bad taglines, right? I mean, gentlemen, what do you think? So, yeah. Let me scroll down here to my other notes. And the In a Dark Match, Lance Cade and Trevor Murdoch, great tag team.
Yeah.
Defeated Brian Kendrick and Paul London. Those four men, the talent in that fucking ring. Different styles. Two different styles. But, you know, you got Cade and Murdoch, traditional Southern style wrestlers, and you got Spanky in London, or you know, cruiserweight high flyer type guys.
Well, back then they feuded for a while, so that was like one of those safe routes where they're like, "All right, we need a dark match. Oh, let's just throw Murdoch and Cade versus Kendrick and London." And it's just like that was a very disposable feud where I love both teams. And right. I would rather have this on the card than, let's say, Kane and Finley. You know, it's just like
we'll get that.
Yeah,
we're getting there. The Kane and Murdoch and Kendrick and London. I think that it was. It sounds like it was a good match to kick off the show. Like that could have gotten the crowd electric. You know what
I
mean?
Oh hell yeah!
Up the volume and people would have fucking really fallen into that match, man.
And I do want to say this makes me sad because the stage for this pay-per-view was just so awesome. This was back when they were creative. They had tiki torches. They had surfboards. I miss when they put that effort in. And it's just sad nowadays because you have the same disposable stage for every pay-per-view. Yeah. And it's just, it's sad. You know, it gave individuality for every pay-per-view. And it's just like, you can't tell one from another nowadays.
Well, yeah, that's correct. But, you know, being a Golden Age era fan, I just want a fucking entranceway, walk to the fucking ring, in a darkened fucking arena, one light over the fucking ring. Go fuck yourself, all the superstars, the fucking Titantron, I think, is a fine idea. I'm going to tell you that, because those people all the way up in the fucking nosebleeds could fucking see the event on the screen. In our first match on the pay-per-view, Kane defeated Finley, and I just got to say that the crowd is wild, all the introductions, and then this? Fucking weird fucking opening match. I'm just like, no, I mean, I love Dave Finley. I think he's a fucking great wrestler, dude.
Yeah.
He really is, but he's also very old school, so he was really out of place in his WWE comeback in this time. He was like really out of place, you know, it seemed like, because he was just too old school for this era in a way. And Kane, I never really cared for, but I've learned to respect the guy at his duties. You know, and I think that you have some of the earliest appearances of what's his face, a little guy, Hornswoggle, in this, and he's just a big goofball in this. You know, it wasn't that. It was way better than expected, though. I will give you that.
One thing I do have to say is, I don't know if you're a big Jack. I know you're not a Jackass fan, but they were supposed to be in the match with Umaga, whereas Wee Man was supposed to face Hornswoggle in a boxing match on this pay-per-view.
Oh, yeah.
That would have been Jesus. Funny.
So this one about 9 minutes. Kane defeated Finlay. Like I said, it went better than expected. It was way better than expected. What do you think about the match itself, DVD Freak?
To me, this is... on paper, it's a SmackDown match, but yes, it turned out cool. You know, I love Dave Finley, and I love Glenn Jacobs. They're two great workers, and they did what they could with an opening match at SummerSlam. I don't think this is an opening match. Like I said before, like you said, I would have preferred the tag match on the card. That, to me, is an opening match, and this is just kind of thrown in there, you know, just to relieve the crowd a little bit. But it's two great workers, but, you know, they kind of made the best of what they could.
Right. JJ, what do you got to say?
It was what it was. I mean, it seemed like you need a big Hawk match. It's not a great opening match, like, you know, popular opinion for an opening match. It's not the best opening match. But I do love Kane's theme song around this time with the lyrics. When that came out, when Kane came out and with the lyrics, I was like, oh, I love that song.
My Chemical is the name of the song. It's a great song.
It is.
Now I'm gonna go listen to it when we're done with the fucking song with the show. I found myself listening to fucking Asuka's theme over and over a couple weeks ago. So I like that song.
That's great. But other than that, I mean, the match is, it's good for what it was, but it was all right. And I love Kane. We're a big guy, moves pretty well.
Yeah.
He's an underrated big guy. And come on, Finley. Not said about him, Finley, but
We can never say enough good things about Finley. The guy's a legend, and he was really terribly underrated wrestler in the United States. You know, outside of the United States, you know, in Japan and wherever, he got his due. But, you know, in the United States, he was a WCW guy, and he just seemed a little bit out of place at this time period in WWE. Yeah. But I'm going to tell you, I always thought it was weird seeing him on WWE TV at this time period, but I always enjoyed it because I was always a fan of his.
Yeah. However, I did enjoy the patch at the beginning of the show, how they showed all of the past logos. I don't know if you remember that during the package before the show started. There was a package, and they showed all the past logos of each SummerSlam really quick. I love that. And I also love Michael Cole's soul patch. I don't know if you got that. I saw that, and it made me want to just punch him in the face.
Please.
I don't like Michael Cole notoriously because all he does is lick Vince McMahon's asshole. But
well, you know, we got the same thought about that. But I'm going to tell you, there is a match on this card that Michael Cole is the best thing a part of. You will find out. Before the end of this episode, you'll find out that I'm going to be like, Michael Cole is the best fucking part of this show because fuck the wrestlers in the ring right now. Anyways, off to our Intercontinental title match. Umaga defeated Carlito and Mr. Kennedy. This wasn't that bad of a match, to be honest with you. This is another one. I'm like, this went 7 minutes, just over 7 minutes. I'm like, this was way better. Like, you look at this and you're like, I was never a Carlito fan. He always annoyed the fuck out of me. Kennedy, I always thought his gimmick was annoying, but he was a decent enough old school style grappler. And Umaga is just Umaga, man. The guy's a fucking beast. You know, I thought it was a better match than expected. It was another one better than expected. Like I said, you guys scared me into this show. I went into this thinking it was going to be just ridiculously crazy.
I went to a live show. The SummerSlam Heatwave Tour. And it was a house show where you had this match and then you had John Cena and Randy Orton as the main event. And this match was, it's three heels at the same time, so there's that dynamic.
Right.
Because this was changed. Like I said, this was going to be the Jackass crew in a handicap match, which I'm really glad didn't happen. But, you know, I love Mr. Kennedy. I don't know about you guys.
Yeah, Carl, I agree.
All right, I'm glad you said that. I'm glad you said that because it seems like no one really talks about him, you know? He seems to get a lot of shit and whatever, but I thought he was good in the ring. He was like an old-school style wrestler. He looked like an old-school style wrestler with the exception of his gimmick. And the gimmick, you know, with the microphone and all that shit, I thought that was corny as fuck. I thought he was a good wrestler.
Well, back then he was the indie darling, you know, for the IWC. That was our guy, and really? I don't disagree. See,
I'm kind of surprised to hear that, to be honest with you, because I don't really remember him, Mr. Anderson, Ken Anderson, prior to coming in WWE. Where did he work prior? Do you know? Indies. Did he have a home? You don't know where his home promotion was?
I don't.
All right. Either way, I thought he was good. I did watch his shoot interview a number of years ago, and I thought it was pretty entertaining as well.
It was, yeah.
Yeah. You talked about how he ended up coming up with the Kennedy gimmick and stuff, talking to McMahon, how McMahon told him he needed a gimmick, and then he just came to him with this, you know, Mr. Kennedy or whatever.
Well, so it's unfortunate because he had the name Kennedy for a reason. It's unfortunate with what happened with his Money in the Bank cash-in. Obviously, it was a failed injury. They misdiagnosed the injury, and it went to Edge instead.
Wow.
So,
yeah.
Basically, they're like, oh, yeah, you're fucked. You're out for a year. And then it ended up just being something that would last, like, a month. Mm-hmm. And so they took it seriously. They're like, oh, we're going to give the Money in the Bank to Edge, which he would eventually cash in on Undertaker.
Right.
Because he was injured. So Mr. Kennedy and WWE is a huge missed opportunity because I'm a huge Ken Anderson fan. I really am.
Same here. Yeah, I agree.
Well, I'm glad to hear people say that, because it's like I always heard people talk shit about him. I own two Ken Anderson shirts, Mr. Anderson, excuse me, Impact era. So it's like I don't really wear them enough, but you know, I think you know, I like the guy personally. I liked his work in the NWA recently, just on NWA Power, and I liked his work in Impact as well.
Yeah.
So this next match is possibly my favorite of the show. Don't laugh. Rey Mysterio and Chavo Guerrero. What the fuck was with the body paint that Mysterio had on? The storyline sucks. Don't get me wrong. The storyline was ridiculous.
Okay.
What is with the body paint?
Okay. So if you remember back at that time, the Fantastic Four sequel was coming out, Rise of the Silver Surfer.
Oh, okay. I see.
So Rey Mysterio paid tribute to that. And the story goes that Vince McMahon backstage flipped out on Dean Malenko because Dean Malenko was the
agent.
Yeah, he was the agent for this match. And he's like, oh, what the fuck is that? That's not Rey Mysterio. And, you know, Rey Mysterio, he's paid tribute to comics many times. Batman, The Flash.
Captain America. Yep.
Daredevil, Captain America, everything. So the body paint was really cool. Because me being a comic book nerd, seeing that, I'm like, dude, Silver Surfer, that is awesome.
See, I didn't even put that together when I saw this. But, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
I just looked at it because I looked away for a few minutes, and I looked up, and I was like, what the fuck is going on here? Like, and then I realized he had body paint all over him. This, like I said, this match I thought was probably the best match of the show.
Yeah.
I think Chavo is not necessarily a great wrestler, part of the, you know, he's decent enough, he's underrated, but I think he's like one of those guys like, oh, I'm a Guerrero, I kind of want to be a wrestler too, and so they kind of trained him, and he's just kind of that guy that wrestled. Should I say not have said that? Am I wrong? I'm sorry to make fun of you, Chavo, I love you, but
I like Chavo, but the way you have to look at it, this was kind of lazy because they faced each other at SummerSlam 2006 in the opening match. So it's just like, I don't know. Like,
they put him in a real storyline. How long had Eddie been dead at this point? 2 years?
Well, he died in November 2005. So
okay, so yeah, two years. Yep, okay.
Yep.
Just about. All right. I don't know. I enjoyed this match a lot, so.
Yeah, this was a good match. Like I said, it's kind of recycled because they had faced each other the year before, but yeah, it makes sense from a storyline standpoint, and it's very predictable. Obviously, this is the SummerSlam of returns. You had Triple H and Rey Mysterio returning. Obviously, they're going
to
go over
here. We'll get to that Triple H. I got something to say about that Triple H match.
Good.
So, yeah, something very deep. The next one is the Battle Royal, the Women's Battle Royal, Beth Phoenix won the Battle Royal by the
last. You not want to hear what I have to say? Or no?
Oh shit, I'm sorry, dude. I just pulled a Danny on you. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I do that.
I love the storytelling. And the last match hit me too as well. So yeah. Anyways, I just like the storytelling. I love the fact that what was his name? JBL called Rey Mysterio Tin Man. I thought that was fucking hilarious because Mysterio came out. I'm like, why the fuck is he dressed like a Tin Man? I don't remember.
Well, like I said, I was confused too as to why he looked that way.
Very confused. And but the storytelling, the fact that it was the return of Rey Mysterio after a serious surgery, what do you have? Torn ACL, torn PCL, and what else? He had a few more than three injuries to his knee, and it's very serious. So, and again, and I don't like JBL, and I don't like Michael Cole, but I have to give them props for their commentary. As much as I hate to give them props on commentary, they told a pretty good story, and not to mention, in the ring, Rey and Chavo told a good story.
Right.
Well, and I also predicted in my notes, I predicted this will be the best match of the night. But I was wrong. There was a different match.
You really think you were wrong? Oh,
okay. I think the main event was the best match of the night. But
hey,
I think
other, like, I'm looking at the rest of the match list in front of me. I'm like, what other match could be the best? I see one other match that could maybe rank, but okay. You think the mess? I mean, the crowd was really into the main event, but. JJ, I'm sorry to not to get to you in that. Yeah, well, there's that too. Tully Blanchard is on my TV with JJ Dillon. Isn't that fucking awesome? Like, seriously, this is the channel that I'm talking to you about, JJ. You got to watch it.
the wrestling app. It's probably
wrestling.
Yeah, I got
it. I highly recommend it. You know what else you need to look up is if you freak, you have a. Streaming device, Roku or the other one.
I'm not big into streaming. I'm a physical media guy, so. Sorry, I do New Japan World, but I don't have Netflix. I don't have Hulu. Fuck all that. So.
Yeah, I remember you saying that a long time ago.
I'm a physical media guy. I don't like streaming.
I love my physical media because I cannot stop buying physical media. But the Roku box has a million different great fucking channels. I mean, you know, there's, and I'm not including the WWE network. There's this thing called Rasslin, which is RASSLIN with that little thing in Bob. And they just, it's like a, I think you had stepped away for a second before we went on air. Last time, JJ, and it was a, basically, you open it up and just starts a, excuse me, Jesus Christ, a random stream of wrestling. A segment will end, then something else. It started off with the Hogan and Warrior from Hartford, Connecticut on Nitro. Now I'm just watching some old NWA Worldwide, and then it went to like some random fucking AWA match and Nikita Koloff match, and then back to some old fucking Robert Gibson's on my TV now. It's a really cool fucking random stream of wrestling. And I think you probably really like it. It's a lot of...
That's cool.
And then another one that I highly recommend for people that have a Roku, and now it is on Fire Stick, is the Jarrett Parsons Network, which is Jerry Jarrett, Jeff Jarrett's father. Mm-hmm. And the Parsons guy, I don't remember his first name, I'm sorry. But they have a free network, and they run like a shit ton of old school wrestling on there. And you can just—it's all free. I think
really?
They, yeah. Oh god, yeah. You can watch. It's all broken up by territory. They have Portland episodes. They own tons of Southern, and we are so getting off track yet again. And I know DVD right. Freaks got to go.
Oh my god, I love. Oh yeah, DVD
got
to go.
It's got some really great shit up there. We I mean, this match, I really don't picture us talking SummerSlam for that much longer. Yeah. This match is
we had the Divas Battle Royal and
we got a lot of talk about that. Everybody's going
thought about that. Wanna know what I thought about that? What bow cannot be tied? Rainbow. Boy.
Jesus,
Jeez, I didn't even think of that.
That's the gimmick right there. But yeah, this Battle Royal, it's 2007 Divas Battle Royal for sure. That's about it.
Divas era, yay, Beth Phoenix.
I'm not the biggest fan of women's wrestling, regardless, but they deserve better. I'll say that.
Yeah. Anyways, right after that bullshit is the. Yep. The ill-fated ECW, WWE CW, or just championship. It's the John Morrison defeated the, that other guy, the straight edge guy. CM Punk. Never been a fan of Morrison's. I met him once in person. Changed my opinion on him. Thought he was a really nice guy. Still don't care for him as a wrestler. Thought he was a really nice guy. Okay. Really cool guy. He was very talkative. Gave me a free copy of his wonderful movie, Boone the Bounty Hunter, that he... I still haven't opened the shit. It's been literally been... It's literally been like 4 years. He's like, here, take this and please give me a review. He goes, I'm not going to charge you. Just take this. And I'm like, oh, man, I really appreciate that. Because me being a hoarder of DVDs, I'm like, no problem. And he asked me to just do a fucking Amazon review, and I never did the Amazon review. Sorry, Morrison. Hennigan. Impact. What other names is he going under? So anyways.
Nitro. He was Johnny Nitro. Blaze. Johnny Blaze was
Johnny Nitro. Was it Johnny Nitro?
And, Nitro when he was with Eminem, Joey Mercury.
Fuck that guy.
I'll tell you what. Fuck Joey Mercury.
If Dan was here, we can't talk about him until Dan.
Oh my god, I wish Dan was here for that one.
Yeah.
Holy shit.
Besides that, But I liked this match. I really did.
I thought this was probably one of the better matches on the event. I said the Mysterio Guerrero match was like the best, but this is definitely up there, I think, as far as.
The thing about this match is it's kind of meaningless because, like I said, 10 wrestlers were suspended after this pay-per-view. Mm-hmm. Technically 11, but they gave Randy Orton kind of a little, they kind of gave him a get-out-of-jail-free card. But so 10 wrestlers got suspended, and one of those was Morrison. Right. So he dropped the title to Punk. So, to be honest, it would have been more meaningful to see CM Punk have his crowning moment at SummerSlam. Yeah. And they could have put on a better match. I will always say that. You know, they had their match at Great American Bash, and then this one. And they had a cool little rivalry going on. So, it would have been cool to have that crowning moment, quotations, if you want to say that. Here.
Yeah.
But they also didn't know that John Morrison was going to be suspended.
Yeah. What exactly was he suspended for?
He was... The way I look at it is this was WWE trying to prove that they were cracking down on the wellness policy. Because this was right after Benoit.
Right.
Yeah. After that, then they started... cracking down, and like you said, what, 12, 10 people got suspended? So.
Well, and we'll get to this, but Booker T, you know, he was part of that suspension as well.
I remember that, yeah.
And that's why he left the company. He was suspended for 60 days, and he was like, you know what, fuck this, I'm going to TNA. He put in, him and Charmel put in their notice after this. But...
yeah.
The reason they were cracking down was because of Benoit. They wanted to prove, oh no, it's not steroids, it's nothing. You know, we're cracking down.
That's
they wanted to make themselves look better for the media.
So
and
they
that's
their employees.
Yeah, wow. So they suspended Kennedy, they suspended Morrison, Booker. You know, this was their way of proving to the world that, oh no, we're very strict about our wellness policy. So if it weren't for Benoit, no one would have got suspended here.
Are you guys hungry? No.
What?
Never mind. You guys want to go out to eat?
Yeah, sure. Let's go out to eat.
I have a pizza on the way, so.
Are you serious? Let's go to the diner, man. Let's go to the diner.
Shit. Yeah. I'll tell you what. Evidently, Trevor is currently making my pizza, so.
Hold on a second. I'm assuming you ordered from Domino's, babe.
Yeah, that...
love Domino's. Yeah.
You know your life sucks when you order from Domino's, but...
Listen, first off, I'm going to be disappointed in the guy to my left, which is JJ. Who lives in Chicago. Chicago is one of three states that is known for the best pizza in the United States of America.
Yeah.
There's no excuse for you, sir.
Well,
New Haven has the best pizza in the world. Fuck New York, all right? It just sucks. I will go for a Chicago deep dish, though. But fuck New York pizza. New Haven. You got Sally's. You got Frank Pepe's. You got Abate's. And I can bring you some little-ass joints on street corners that are the fucking best pizza in the world. I'm going to tell you, man. I tell all my friends that don't live in Connecticut. So you come to Connecticut, man, you come and visit, man, I'll take you on a fucking pizza tour. That's like the main thing we're doing. I think I told you, JJ, go on a pizza tour, and we'll go fucking, and we're going to go on a fucking brewery tour as well, man. Sorry, we're getting off the track on wrestling again.
All right. Can we agree? Have you ever had King's Pizza? Any of you?
I don't even know. Is that like some Greek guy?
No, it's in New York. I like New York style.
I don't like New York pizza. I'm in New Haven.
No.
Born and raised in New Haven, Connecticut. New Haven is a legendary pizza.
Okay.
I'm just telling you, I always say
don't knock it till you try it. So
yeah. You guys never heard of Sally's or Frank Pepe's?
No. I never heard of it. I just like Domino's because I tend to get Domino's if a girlfriend is in college, we get Domino's pizza, and it's convenient, it's cheap, and it's good. That's why I like Domino's.
It's good late night food because it's it's just there.
John is currently delivering my Domino's pizza at the moment. So
are you going to have to step away to answer the door? Or,
no, my girlfriend is on that. Girlfriend. But okay. I'll tell you what. Domino's is one of my least favorite pizza joints, but it's the only one that's open till midnight, so I will take it.
Yep. It's only open till midnight where you are?
Yep.
What? I'm going to tell you, the one that lives near us is open till 3 a.m. Yeah. However, the one that's like that way closes at like 10 o'clock at night. And I'm like, why are you closed at 10? I used to go and pick up my daughter, order pizza. And then they'd call me and be like, I'm sorry, we're closing in 10 minutes. You have to cancel your order. I'm like, what the fuck, man? I said, you still have a half an hour. They're like, I'm sorry, we're closing down our machines. I'm like, you fucking suck. But the one over here that's like closest to my house is open till I think like 2 during the week and like 3 on like Friday and Saturday, bar hours basically.
Yeah, because you're in a college town.
Quinnipiac is literally around the corner. Yep. Should we talk more wrestling?
Yeah, the thing about SummerSlam.
I love
Domino's. I'll take Pizza Hut over Domino's any day.
All right, listen to me. Listen to me. Okay, hang on a second.
Oh, boy.
I didn't think it'd get much worse. I would take Domino's or Pizza Hut any motherfucking
day. Oh,
fuck. The last time I had Pizza Hut, I'm like, this tastes like garbage. And I literally got so sick. And I have a heartburn. I have a reflux problem as well. And,
so do I.
Pizza Hut. I'm on medication for it. And Pizza Hut is one of those things that makes it even worse for me.
Well, I'm lactose intolerant, so that doesn't really help me much. But
this is telling stories over here on the podcast.
I have a lot of problems. I have depression.
JJ,
irritable bowel syndrome. So,
JJ, you want to expose anything? The irritable bowel. Jesus Christ. Let me just tell you this. I can't hold my liquor. I pee every 3 seconds after I gotta have a drink. So
I have to pee really bad, but I'm holding it.
Oh, I just did. But anyways, Triple H and King Booker. The King Booker thing was kind of enjoyable in a comedic way. But like I said, Freak, you agree with me? We don't like comedy in our wrestling, but it's this was kind of one of the very few exceptions. I know there is some exceptions. Because I think Booker T is one of those guys, at this point, he was around for so long. He's one of those guys that can just go on TV and do whatever the fuck he really wanted. You know what I'm saying? Whether, you know, he didn't even fucking care as long as he was getting a paycheck. And he just went out there he still put on decent matches. The fucking opening to this match. And the match clocks in at 7 minutes and 58 seconds. The introductions alone were about 20 minutes. Between Booker's entrance and walking to the ring. And literally, I'm just like kind of spacing out. And then Booker's Hunter's entrance happens. And then I'm looking up. I'm like, wait, the bell's just ringing now? And literally, I was there for about a good 10 minutes. Like, waiting for this shit to start. I didn't even realize it. And I was just like, holy shit, I can't believe this is just starting now.
Well, this was Booker's final pay-per-view until Royal Rumble 2011, I think. Oh, so,
wow. Oh, he's gone that long? Wow.
Yeah, he was in TNA. And
I remember him going to TNA, yeah.
Yeah, and, you know, this match, it's like the Rey Mysterio match. Obviously, Triple H is going over here. Like, come on. How stupid can you be? Obviously, well, Triple H is going over.
It was 2007. I mean, I think Hunter, and I think Brian Alvarez said the rest. The best is, like, Hunter buried everybody.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm notoriously not a Booker T fan. I actually quite hate Booker T. But he'd been around since 2001 in the WWF. Mm-hmm. So he was kind of in the mix here. He lost his world title to Batista in 2006 at Survivor Series. So he was very much in the mix here where there just wasn't really a place for him. And I did not like the King Booker. It made him a joke. It made him a comedic character. So the only times I can take Booker seriously is when he's Booker T, not King Booker.
Right.
And, you know, this match did nothing for anyone except Triple H.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I always liked Booker. I met him around this time, I think. It was around this time? Yeah, it was around this time. I know he wasn't doing the King Booker gimmick, so, you know, it's probably right after or something. But I did meet him, and I thought that he was one of the most, like, the nicest, most genuine human beings you'd ever want to meet, to be honest with you. Like, he was cool. He shook my hand. He actually, you know, had a great conversation with me. When he was doing the signing, he had still probably 100 or so people to go before me. You know, good guy, though, I thought. And I thought that I kind of enjoyed this match, but it was like one of those whatever matches, you know, it was better for Triple H than it was Booker T. JJ, what did you think, buddy?
I really liked hearing Motorhead, even though that,
yeah,
that entrance was a bit of overkill. But it was also nice to hear Motorhead. The match, like, yeah, like you said, it was great. But the crowd was into it. The crowd was really into it, so it into it. And but I do love King Booker at this time. Yeah, it was funny and it made him into a joke. I get it, but it got him heat, and it worked. Yeah. So yeah, but besides that, I always liked King Booker, and I always loved Booker T. I was always a huge fan of Booker T. Back when he was in Harlem Heat when I was a kid. And one of my
great tag team, man. Great tag team.
Yeah. And one of my favorite in general was when Booker came out in the crowd and attacked Stone Cold while he was holding the WCW heavyweight title. Oh man, when I saw that, I marked out. So that's one of my favorite. Yeah,
he was one of the greatest in WCW in the later days. I think he was their final champion. Yeah, right. On paper, I mean, like legitimate WCW, not when WWE like, was doing the feud. Yeah, I mean, who the hell won the belt from him?
Won the belt. Oh, I don't remember who won it from.
No, somebody. Yeah, it's possible. Him or The Rock, I think, at that period. They were doing the whole thing where they're having WWF guys and the Invasion win the, what am I calling? WCW titles. So,
yeah, but I mean, remember.
I don't know. Do you really? Would you count that as the original lineage in WCW? Or no?
What do you mean?
When there was the invasion, right? And the guys and when WCW guys started coming over and they were bringing the belts and all that other shit, and then WWE guys started beating them for the. Would you count that as part of the lineage, like the official lineage?
No, I don't.
Freak seems like he's coming back, but oh shit, you guys switched up. Did you hear my question, Freak?
No, I did not. I had to get my pizza.
We're talking about how Booker was the final WCW champion, and then during the invasion era, it was all the WWF guys beating everybody for the WCW titles. And I asked JJ if he, would consider any of those part of the original, like the official WCW lineage of. Champions, would you consider those guys, because you know WWE just bought out WCW, would you consider that, or would you just consider it when it closed the official lineage of the titles?
I 100% say when it was closed, because Vince manipulated the legacy of WCW.
He most certainly did, especially during that invasion angle. He made WCW look incredibly weak. And especially the people that were in there that he was using. I mean, do you realize that, like, the majority of some of the people that he used, you remember when they were building up for it and guys would show up on Raw sitting in the stands? It was all guys like fucking Lash LaRue and people like that. You know what I mean? Like, no offense to Lash LaRue. I mean, he was a decent worker. But, you know, it's like, and then those guys really don't work much for the company, WWE. You get what I'm saying? They were trying to make WWE look weak in a way. They couldn't really get their hands on the gigantic talent, with the exception of a few guys at that time period. Was that JJ?
They made them look second rate.
Yeah. Vince is all about making people look second rate, you know? So, I mean.
I get. Well, after this match, we had. My notes say the Great Khali versus Batista.
I got a lot to say about this match. Well,
my God. This was originally supposed to be Edge versus Kane at Great American Bash, and then obviously Edge was out. Mm-hmm. So you just kind of gave the title to Khali, and this is a fucking disaster.
There's no one more deserving than Khali for the title. I'm kidding. Khali does not leave his feet for like a good portion of the match. And then he just like kind of, I get he's trying to build this character. You know, he's like guy that. Remember when I told you guys I was, you know, my goal was the best part of one of these matches on tonight's show? This is the fucking match, man. Michael Cole was the best part of this fucking match because God bless you, Dave Bautista. You know, I know you're a good guy and a somewhat okay worker. But Khali, man, this is cringeworthy material right here. And when you're saying Michael Cole was the best part of the match, it's really fucking cringeworthy.
Yep.
You know, I'm sitting here fucking dying through this. I'm like, you just have to put his. He does not actually go for any type of legit cover until, like, really late in the match, Khali. And it's just... But kudos to Batista. Legitimately, kudos to Batista for trying for this match. He really tried to help make Khali look pretty decent. But this is just... Oh, God, man. I had a hard time. I almost fast-forwarded through it, but somehow... I knew what the main event was, so I didn't fast forward this one.
Well, the problem is this is technically your second biggest pay-per-view of the year. Your world title match should never go to a disqualification. And the previous year went the same way with a disqualification. Yeah, with Booker and
but I tend Batista. To I tend to disagree with you on that because this I depending on how it fits in the story, but he just knew something was coming. He knew a disqualification or some bullshit. And first off, Michael Cole was it? Referred to the referee. The referee was Mickey J for this match. Michael Cole got his fucking name wrong. Called him Mickey Hastings or some bullshit, and I'm like. I'm like, no, that's Mickey J. I mean, the notorious WCW referee. And he used a job in WWF, actually, as a wrestler back in the early 90s. I don't know. There's a photo out there. I'm going to have to send it to you. Maybe we'll put it in the thumbnail for this show. But
I didn't know.
Yeah. He's got a really sick-ass mullet, too, dude. So, like, I'm telling you. But, yeah, this match is just so it only went 7 minutes. That must say something, right?
Yeah, and yeah, this is just it's making the best of what you have, I guess. But Great Khali, he didn't even know what the hard camera was. If you remember the one battle, he didn't even know where to hold the title, like.
He held it upside down half the fucking time.
Let's he's not the worst of all time, but
wait, hold up.
Who I find
the worst
it
if you don't consider Khali's the worst. Who's the worst?
I don't know, but but I wouldn't say he's more of the giant Gonzalez, I'll say. But,
all right. You know, I think you just said, I just said who's the worst, and, you know, I'd have to say,
I'm going to have to
be a giant Gonzalez. Yeah. I'm sorry.
like I said, though, he's not the worst of all time, but what the fuck were you thinking? Like,
yeah.
You could have easily put it on Batista, Kane, because if you remember, the triple threat match at Great American Bash was Kane, Khali, and Batista. You could have easily just thrown it on one of them, or Mark Henry even, for the Battle Royal. And it's just like, it's baffling to me. Why the fuck did you pick the green Great Khali? Because he was only in the company, I think he made his debut in 2006.
Really? I kind of figured as much. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just like, it's shocking, because of all people, you pick the Great Khali, and then you have a 7-minute match at SummerSlam with Batista to go to a DQ. Like, this is embarrassing. It really is.
Great Khali, future WWE Hall of Famer. All
right. Honestly, it will happen. He will be in the Hall of Fame. He will.
Wait a second. I'm saying here, Mickey, I'm looking at the referee list now. What did they say? Mickey what? Mickey J was his real name, but Mickey Henson. It's listed here as Mickey Henson for this match. Yeah. So at some point, Mickey J switched his name. In WCW, he definitely did go by the name Mickey J. I don't know.
Maybe there was some kind of legal thing. I don't know.
Yep. I'm looking at his profile right here. It is Mickey J. So it's, you know, okay. It's possible. I don't know. I just thought I've never heard him referred to as that other than this match. Legit. And he debuted in 1980. Hold up a second. He debuted in 1987. Holy sheep shit. All right. Yeah.
Sheep shit. All
right. So I'm totally getting off track. I'm being an idiot, which is nothing out of the ordinary.
Yeah. What else is new here? We're all idiots.
It's the cast of characters, but legitimately, we are missing one of the most important characters tonight. Danny, to let you know, we're about to cover the main event, but Dan, we're thinking of you, buddy.
Yeah.
Still, you know, he's been on my mind this whole time. I hope everything's all right. In the main event, John Cena defeated Randy Orton. I don't really have much to say about this. Looking back, I'm kind of a little bit more lenient towards Cena nowadays, because I'm not watching it live and being like, Jesus Christ, this motherfucker's going over again.
Yeah,
Jesus Christ, he kicked out again. God damn, I hate his jean shorts. goddamn, you know, his music is whatever, you know. But, you know, growing up as an adult, I hated him when he was on TV at that time period, watching it live. Nowadays, I'm watching it, I'm like, he was never the greatest wrestler of all time. He never was. But, you know, he's no Steamboat, he's no Flair, he's no Tito Santana, he's not even fucking able to hold fucking any of their jock straps. But, you know, he's still a fucking, I think he holds his place in the business based on.
I'll tell you what, it's kind of like the modern Roman Reigns, where I fucking hate him with a passion. Yeah. And back then, I was like, you know, fuck Cena. But looking back now, you see the dedication, the passion.
Yeah.
I respect John Cena so much, even though he's not my favorite in-ring talent. But he did get better. Like, if you look at, like, some of his 2013 matches, you know, even, like, 2011 with Punk, he knew how to put on a good match, but that wasn't his position.
I'm going to tell you something. I'm glad you brought that up, because I could not stand the fucking guy. And I was like, this guy can't fucking wrestle. Like, actually wrestle, can't fucking grapple. And then when him and Cena got in the ring, they put up one of the him and Punk got in the ring, the title versus title.
Yeah.
They put on one of the greatest fucking wrestling clinics in WWE, you know what I mean, at level. You get what I'm saying? It's like, I could not believe that he actually was there grappling move for move with Punk. I was like, this guy can actually fucking work. I get that he's a character, and that's what he's dedicated to. And his ability to make fun of himself. So that is very respectful in places like, you know, it's like, I know I'm ridiculous, I know my character's ridiculous, and I know that you get it, kind of a thing. So, that kind of a thing. And that's why I respect him, because he was over with the kids, we'll say that.
Yeah. And this was their first, Randy Orton and John Cena, this was the first singles pay-per-view match, which will become a running joke because they had so many matches together. 2009, they would revive that at SummerSlam 2009, which, you know, bragging rights, they had their Iron Man match in 2009.
Was that a 60-man Iron Man match?
Yep. And it actually was a pretty good match, I will say that. Iron Man match.
I love Iron Man matches. I'm a sucker for them.
Exactly. That's my favorite match type.
And I'm cringeworthy at thinking about an Iron Man match between these two. So, what I think is going to happen, I'm not going to look forward to reviewing the entire show of Bragging Rights, but I'm interested in watching that whole match and just reviewing that match.
It's a good match. And that's saying something. Because, like I said, back then, I was not a Cena fan. And back then, I also wasn't really an Orton fan. It took a few years for me to appreciate both of them.
Right. I'm still necessarily not, but like I said, you know, it's lineage. The lineage is family. And so I always thought he was kind of arrogant. I heard he was a dick backstage. But, you know, there was a couple things that, one thing that really stuck with me that made me respect Orton was when they first started working Saudi Arabia, people were getting on WWE's case. Don't laugh. Hold up.
Saudi shit show.
Yeah, exactly. But one of the things was, like, you know, a lot of people supposedly, especially, is like, oh, I'm canceling my WWE now. Maybe not. You're going to join next month when the next fucking pay-per-view is. Shut the fuck up. don't be so fucking ridiculous. Yeah, the IWC is a ridiculous and toxic fucking environment.
Yep.
So anyways, somebody approached Orton and they fucking videoed and made its way to YouTube. It's like, why are you going to Saudi Arabia? Yada, yada, this and that. He goes, one of the things, and I respect this, changed my opinion about him as a human being, because if you know, he always had like a bad rap of being an idiot and an asshole in his younger years. He said, I have a family to feed. I'm going to go anywhere this company asks me to go, basically. I've always respected that.
Yeah.
Because I have a family to feed. I'm going there. I'm getting a huge payday for this fucking event. And I respect that. So, that's it.
Well, in a lot of ways, you have to look at like guys like The Undertaker, where he is very loyal. And 100%. Randy Orton is very loyal. And I'm a huge fan of The Miz. I don't know about you guys, but
I think he gets a lot of shit. He's a goofball in real life, but you know, I like him.
But
enjoy him.
He's loyal.
Yeah.
And I respect loyalty.
This was his dream to be joining the WWE, you know, and then he got there and he's fucking loyal.
Well, I remember.
I don't see The Miz ever going anywhere else.
I remember when he was on The Real World. So
I never watched that or The Road Rules or any of that garbage. I was not a reality TV fan. I sure as fuck am not now. But
it's a guilty pleasure. But
yeah. I'm sorry to hear that.
I know. I hate myself. But hey, sometimes I'm like, you know, I hate myself. Let's hurt myself today. So I watch reality TV.
Wait, you actually watch reality TV, bro?
I watch 90 Day Fiancé. That's about it. But
Shit. Wait, you really watch that? Oh, wait, we had this discussion.
Yeah, I watch it because it's a psychology field day. I'm huge into psychology.
And you're friends with Lisa. That's why you watch it. Did she ask you to marry her?
No, I met her though once. She actually came into my store coincidentally, because I live like 10 minutes away from Lisa and Usman.
You say she was friends with your? Oh, is Usman is? I feel bad for him. I really do. I think he's.
Too, man.
I have not really kept up on the newest. I don't know what you're talking about. I don't watch 90 Day Fiancé. Never mind. I haven't kept up on this season as much. But
the thing about SummerSlam.
The thing about SummerSlam.
So do you watch any, as according to other reality shows, and I watch some of these, I sit down with my wife on whatever night that certain shows are on. My wife is like, loves reality TV. And that's how I kind of got into 90 Day Fiancé. And I watch Married at First Sight with her as well. What do you think of that show?
I've never seen it, but I am huge into psychology, especially like sexuality and relationships. So that's why I like it, because I literally analyze these people the entire thing. So it's like
I sit there and drink and make fun of them because I'm, and then I turn to my wife and said, "This fucking bitch is crazy." Like, you know, like some of these women are fucking crazy.
Yeah.
Legit. Oh, I met some guy from some weird country, and then now, like, you saw 90 Day Fiancé. I can't even believe we're discussing this on a pro wrestling podcast.
SummerSlam.
Where Lisa, they had to buy, where Usman made Lisa buy a goat for his mother.
Yeah, I saw that. And it's just like, she was like,
"You're not marrying my son." Like, you know, it was fucking beautiful. I was just like, if I was his mother, I'd be like, fuck no, get the fuck out of here.
Well, it's just like, it's like, oh my God. Yeah, and like, I geek out because like, every time they filmed with Lisa, I know exactly where they're filming. Because that's the White Rose. Like, I've been there.
I'm gonna have to go back and watch it, because like, it's like her friends look like real fucking winners too. The ones that are sitting with her in the earlier episodes.
Yeah, that's Rocky. I know Rocky. Like, it's just like,
that's funny.
I gotta tell my wife all this shit. Like
David, bring her in, dude. I'll talk to her. Bring her in. We'll have a podcast about 90 Day Fiancé.
See, that's the next. See, I'm looking to start other shows. That's the new one. So SummerSlam. wrestling fans that have heard this, don't judge us, please. Love of God. When you have a significant other that doesn't always control what you watch, can't always watch wrestling. See, Cena, blah blah blah. I think this started Cena's gigantic run, pretty much, right? As a babyface, basically winning every single match for like however many fucking years.
Well, the thing is, this rivalry was supposed to go on, but he had got injured, So at Unforgiven that year, he was supposed to face Cena. Or, oh my God, I don't know what I'm saying. But Cena was supposed to face Orton in a Last Man Standing match at Unforgiven.
Right.
And that didn't happen because, or No Mercy, I should say. At No Mercy, it was going to be Cena and Randy Orton, Last Man Standing. And obviously the whole Kennedy thing went down.
Wow.
And Cena got injured.
Oh,
so, at No Mercy, it was basically Randy Orton was handed the title. And then, you know, he lost it to Triple H, and then Triple H faced Umaga, and then Triple H lost it to Orton at the same pay-per-view. So, yeah, this rivalry was supposed to go on, and this was, once again, supposed to be Cena's year, but he got injured, so.
JJ.
What up?
give your opinions. I don't want to feel like I'm ignoring you.
The match was, it was good for what it was. It was a good long match. Had a lot of rest holds. You know?
I love that. This is actually a really good match. I'm not going to lie. Like I said, growing older, I like Cena now a lot more and pay attention to him. Sorry, JJ, go keep going.
Oh, and I also like, Randy. Hey, nothing left to say. Nothing. I remember that because it was one of my, it's probably my favorite theme song, Randy.
JJ, I gotta ask you a question. I think I've asked you this before. What's that poster by your head?
That's Rick and Morty.
Rick and Morty.
Son of a bitch. I thought it was David Bowie.
Yeah.
All right.
No. That's not David Bowie.
I don't know what the fuck Rick and Morty is. I'm sorry.
I can see the you know, why you would think it would be David Bowie because of the hair. But no, it's Rick from Rick and Morty.
I've never seen Rick and Morty before. I mean, is this something I should watch? Hold up. Motherfucker. You said you don't stream shit. I thought this shit was only available to stream. Am I wrong? Am I incorrect?
I said I stream.
No, I'm talking about the nerd, the DVD nerd. Freak.
I have other ways of watching it. Let's put it this way.
You bootleg.
If you have an offensive sense of humor, you'll like this show. And
I am watching this tonight.
Yeah. It's a very intellectual sense of humor. It's offensive, intellectual. I think the first few episodes, they're trying to figure everything out. But once you get, like, to the second season, this show is genius. And it kind of goes...
This is a Hulu show? Am I wrong?
No, it's Adult... Oh, God. Was it Adult Swim?
It's Adult Swim, but you can find all the episodes on Hulu. They are.
But I could probably watch it on regular, like, say, whatever my cable company on demand, because that Adult Swim is Comedy Central or some bullshit, right?
Yeah.
If I have Comedy Central, I'll be able to find it most likely. All right, I'm looking this shit up tomorrow.
Yeah.
Like I said, the first season is kind of a feeling out process, but the farther you get into it, it is genius. It is a great intellectual, offensive sense of humor, and I love it.
Yeah, it's out there, man. I love
so we wanted to. How would you grade this show? Not Rick and Morty. I'm talking SummerSlam because we keep getting off track. Because we should probably wrap it. We need to wrap it up pretty soon because we're going overtime as far as DVDs request. Because hectic as fuck work schedule coming up this week.
Well, I got my pizza, so I can go a little longer. I just gotta go.
Oh
yeah.
You can totally eat while YouTubing. I mean, just saying.
I don't know. I'm a little professional, so I don't want to be chomping around with fucking pizza while I'm...
You're drinking, admitting to pissing in a cup on it. Oh, shit. Maybe that wasn't on there. Anyways,
right,
I just went
to... All right, you know what? Twice. Fuck it. I'm going to get my pizza then.
See? There you go. I should go out and go get a pizza. Anyways. JJ, what's happening, brother?
I would grade the show a C minus. We're talking about the show. Well,
I'm going to be honest with you guys.
Yeah, I'm going to go with Randy.
I'll be honest, because DVD Freaking Dan made it seem like I was walking into a complete shit show. Like, it was just from top to bottom. It would scare the shit out of me and be complete garbage. I'd have to go with more so a B minus. Because it was better than expected. And, I mean, granted, the opener was a very strange opener, Kane and Finlay. I thought it was a decent match, and I like both guys, both like and respect both guys. There's not a lot of wrestlers on this card I actually don't care for watching. You know, everybody was pretty legendary status, yada, yada. Nice pizza. Yeah. So
it was better than I expected. It was a lot
way better than I expected, I was led to believe, I'll tell you that as well.
Yeah, that was great.
Bad. The thing is, this pay-per-view went through a lot of changes because of Benoit.
Yeah, I have to look more into the history. I did not have, I'm sorry for you to cut you off.
No.
I did not have a lot of time this week to actually study the entire background build up to this episode. It's been a really great, crazy and hectic week. Yeah, I kind of figured there was a lot of changes due to Benoit, and Benoit is pretty effective into this scenarios that happened here.
I will give this show a C+, which is average. Yeah, it's not bad. Yeah. But let's say you had The Undertaker show up like he was supposed to. Yeah, that would have been great. But at the same time, I think it benefited from the Benoit incident, as much as I hate to say that, because, you know, the whole Jackass crew, I love Jackass. I have that guilty pleasure, you know, that dick and fart joke sense of humor sometimes.
I'm going to tell you, they're not dick and fart jokes. Kevin Smith is where it's at. And I'm talking about his earliest days. I'm not talking about nowadays. I don't even know what the fuck he does nowadays.
Did you ever see the picture where I met Jay Muse and Kevin Smith at AEW?
You told me about that. Yeah, I don't think you showed me the picture. But
I'll tell you what. One of my greatest FYE finds ever. I have a Clerks DVD signed by Kevin Smith, Brian Anderson, Jay Muse, and, or not Brian Anderson, Brian O'Halloran, sorry, and then Jeff Anderson.
How I found in God's that, name did you find this signed in an FYE? In the used?
Yeah, I have it. I can show it to you sometime. God. I was literally browsing an FYE. It's an FYE, it's like 45 minutes away from me. And I looked at it, I'm like, dude, that's Kevin Smith's signature. Because I'm a huge Kevin Smith fan. So Clerks is one of my all-time favorite films.
Absolutely.
And yeah. I've actually been to the Quick Stop. Very cool place to go.
Oh, cool.
And I'll send you a picture sometime of this DVD. I don't have it with me, but I'll bring it over for sure. It's signed by Kevin Smith, Brian O'Halloran, Jeff Anderson, Jay Muse. It's so cool. And then I have my picture of Jay Muse. I met him at the AEW show that him and Kevin Smith were at. So,
let me ask you something. Do you know that this is for sure their signatures? It was a certificate of authenticity, have you compared it to some online? That's what I do when I find something autographed. I usually Google the person's signature. That's what I did like recently.
Well, I have a for one of Kevin Smith's comic books.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the same signature, man.
All right. That's awesome. That's amazing. Because I know growing up, nobody really ever cared about COAs until like recently. It seems like the last few years, that's when it all, you know, the whole COA thing was like a thing. You get what I'm saying?
Well, like I actually.
Then, yeah.
You know, this makes sense because the DVD I have, it's the Clerks X DVD release, which they did this humongous signing for this Clerks X DVD release. And everyone that signed it matched up. because it's exactly it's actually personalized as well, which is it sucks, but like I'll take it because it's still their signatures.
Yeah, I
made a video on it a long time ago, but it's signed to Anthony. So if Anthony's out there, let me know.
He must have needed the money for some weed or something in order to sell it. So.
Yeah. I've seen a few autographed DVDs at FYE. I once found a Matt Hardy WrestleMania 25 Blu-ray at FYE. So.
Wow. That's
interesting. I didn't buy it, but I saw it.
Usually if things are autographed and I find it at a place like that, I'd probably pick it up and then flip it, you know?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of which, gentlemen, do you, either of you have anything interesting to tell the world or speak about before we go?
Can we talk about pizza? I have some good deep dish pizza.
I already told you, you motherfuckers need to come to New Haven for fucking pizza. I'll take you on a pizza tour. I will fucking pay for the shit if you guys come up here, and but you all can buy the beer. I'll buy the pizza. So
I'm down.
You guys get my game for a few days. I'm telling you, man, we got the best pizza in the world.
Okay.
I'm out. I'll pick you up on my way.
Fuck yeah, I'll do it, man.
Seriously.
Yeah. I'll bring the beer.
All right.
Well, I get to my vacation time next year.
I always cash my vacation for extra money.
There's been times I used to do that shit too.
Yeah.
Anyways, folks, JJ, where can people find you?
You can find me at Double J S I Double N Z on everything but Facebook. I'm most active on Snapchat.
Can you please join the DVD room for fuck's sake? Like, come on.
He's not on Facebook.
I'm not on Facebook.